Call to order. Regular meeting of Ascension Parish Council, June 1st, 2017. Please stand for the invocation to be given by Councilman Kluat and remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. Lord, as this day we start upon the 2017 hurricane season here in South Louisiana, we ask that you look upon our area and comfort us. And please take care of the folks, as we still have plenty of people out of their homes from the flood of last August. Lord, it's with a heavy heart we ask for special prayers to put your hand upon the Little family for the loss of Coach Butch Little, a great guy, a character, and a wonderful citizen. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Hey, roll call, Madam Secretary. I have Councilman Turner absent, Councilman Dempsey Lambert absent, everyone else present. We do have a quorum. Item number 3, chair additions. There are no chair additions. Public comment period, so if you want to make a comment on an agenda item, there are cards to fill out at the podium. Fill those out with the agenda item you'd like to comment on and bring them to the secretary. And first presentation tonight is the Ascension Catholic Girls Track Team. So that parish president going to make those that presentation, or is that the first one is Ascension Catholic Girls Track Team? I assume that's them over here. So you guys must have all run 4 or 5 races.
Okay. Parish of Ascension is proud to present the certificate of achievement to this team and coach. I don't know, coach is, yes, coach is, for their part in helping Ascension Parish School girls track in history and make history by becoming the first 1A school to win district, regional, and state championship for a consecutive 3 years. So, 3 year consecutive back-to-back. We want to congratulate them and give them these certificates. And let's give them another hand. Okay, Coach Daniel.
Where's everybody?
Disney World. I went to Disney World.
I'm the coach. Captain Burrow. Captain Daigle. How about just take a good picture? Come on, let's go. Does anybody want to take a picture? Anybody want to be in the picture?
Yeah, I want to be.
Well, y'all come back here.
Come on, we gotta go up there.
I tell you what, just like many of you, we're not here.
We're 18 in the family, huh?
Could the adults please get behind the young lady? They're athletic, but they're small. I did not say that. I did not say that. By the way, I was told earlier these young ladies want to challenge the council to a track meet.
We forfeit. We concede.
The ladies, Councilwoman Canzo, if you want to put together a team, we'll.
All I can be is the cheerleader. Thank you.
Okay, the next item, we have the parish president's report, and we have a special ceremony for the renaming of the Donaldsonville jail.
As y'all all know, there's a jail behind us that was built. It was the first jail of Ascension Parish, and at the time when it was built, the sheriff put Mr. Trepanier in charge of the jail, and so, but what he did was he had to live in the jail, which his wife cooked the meals for their family that lived on the bottom and the prisoners on the top. And then later through the years, we just gave y'all a little bit of stuff that they have there. There's a ton of paraphernalia we're going to do and put in that building when we do it. And I do have here tonight the daughter, Miss Virgie LeBlanc. Would you come up, Miss Virgie? And, you know, he later on became the chief of police until he retired from in Donaldsonville. But he was the first one that ran this jail and through the years, and then he ended up building a jail on the East Bank. But this was the first jail of Ascension Parish. You want to say anything, Virgie?
I just want to say to each and every one of you, I'd be honored for y'all to vote and do this for my daddy. He's devoted his whole lifetime to his parish and his community in Donaldsonville and Ascension Parish. Everyone loved him and couldn't say a bad thing about him through all his years. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Reagan. And also, we have two of our employees, or the grandsons, Mr. Andrew Banana LeBlanc and Michael LeBlanc. So, oh, I'm sorry, it's in Rosemary. Rosemary, you come up here. His whole life was law enforcement, and he lived it from the start to the finish. So, anyway, I appreciate that.
Mr. Chairman, you need a motion?
Yeah. Do we need a motion?
Yes, for approval.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make the motion to rename the old Donaldsonville Jail in honor of Mr. Charles Chalut Trepanier.
I second that motion.
Well, motion and a second. Any discussion? Any opposition? Motion carries.
That's all I have on my report tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Item number 7, the consent agenda. Item A, bid to accept the lowest responsive bid for the right to act as the official journal. Item B, adoption of the May 4th, 2017 regular council minutes. Item C, adoption of the May 18th, 2017 regular council minutes.
So moved.
Is there any desire to remove anything from the consent? have a motion by Councilman Cagnolotti to accept the consent agenda, second by Councilman Johnson. Any discussion? Any opposition? Consent agenda is adopted. General business, item number 8. First item is resolution to limit to no more than 2 feet in flood zones A and E. To limit fill to no more than 2 feet in zones A and E. So we have a resolution. Sorry, I'll actually find it.
Can you get me a hard copy too?
This is a resolution to modify Appendix 5, Drainage Section 17-507 of the Ascension Parish Unified Land Development Code related to the placement of fill height of embankment. Whereas by ordinance, the Ascension Parish Council has set standards for the placement of fill on lots for residential and commercial construction, and whereas as a result of the flood of August 2016, thousands of residential homes were damaged or destroyed by floodwaters, and whereas the Ascension Parish Council desires to prevent future flood damage to properties near or adjacent to properties elevated with fill material, whereas the Ascension Parish Council desires to introduce this resolution at its regularly scheduled meeting of June 15, 2017, therefore be it resolved, the Ascension Parish Council authorizes the Ascension Parish President to proceed as follows. Modify Appendix 5, Drainage Section 17-507 of the Ascension Parish Unified Land Development Code to temporarily limit the height of fill embankment that can be placed on a parcel of any size and a subdivision of any size to 24 inches within designated FEMA zones A and AE. The height of fill embankment created by earth and material even taken from within the lot or brought onto the lot from an outside source cannot create an elevation difference greater than 24 inches from natural grade. Roman numeral 2, promote the use of pier and beam construction within FEMA zones A and AE to comply with the parish floodplain ordinance. Roman numeral 3, those properties subject to the August 2016 flood event are exempt from items 1 and 2 above. Roman numeral 4, conduct a series of workshops with appropriate professional personnel related to the placement of fill embankment within Ascension Parish. Conduct a study of the floodplains and drainage basins within Ascension Parish to determine the proper maximum height of fill for development. A licensed professional engineer with hydraulic capability shall perform the study. Be it further resolved, the application of the above fill embankment limitations do not apply to those projects within an existing building permit or projects that have a preliminary plat approved by the Ascension Parish Planning Commission. And I apologize for getting a little bit ahead of myself here, but I do have some speakers on this item, so I'd like to take those at this time. Did Randy Shin, is that correct? S-H-I-N-N?
Good evening. I'm Randy Shin, 17566 Simpson Road, Prairieville, Louisiana. In regards to doing a basic 24-inch or 2-foot fill, it's unacceptable. To say that you're going to just say everybody in those areas can have 24 inches of fill, you may be going 8 to 10 inches higher than the person next door. You may be 24 inches higher than the person next door. Now, if you were going to say this strictly on a residential lot, that would be fine. You're not talking about acres that are going to go up 24 inches. You're talking about maybe 5,000 square feet, let's say, the size of someone's home. When you start talking about acres going up 24 inches, that's unacceptable. I say that because I would be one of those people who would be under the subdivision next door. Louisiana's got a law. I'm sure you guys know it better than me. But there's two civil laws that protect homeowners. And it talks about the flow of water. And it regards to not people, but the land. And the owner of an estate which has water that runs through it can't stop it, can't change the course of it. These are civil laws 656 and 658. If you'd like, I could read them, or you can look them up for yourself. I think better if you look them up for yourself, because I'm not the best public speaker. But 656 talks about the owner of the dominant estate, which is all the existing homeowners are considered dominant estates, to any lot that is lower than them. So to say that you're going to have a 24-inch fill, you're kind of taking away from the civil law all the existing dominant estates that are lower in that surrounding area. With regards to the, should I go ahead and do 8 and 9?
Or should I have to wait till 9 comes up.
Okay. But the fill itself is not acceptable as a blanket policy.
Thank you. Okay. Ms. Shawla Johnson.
Thank you, Chair. Charlotte Johnson, I live in District 2, 9346 South Hodgson. I've been there 30 years and love where I live. Challenges have been, of course, our drainage situation, which I appreciate Mr. Bill Rue and then my councilman, Bill Dawson, assisting me with that. On the resolution, I guess I'm just want clarification and consideration on understanding, is the resolution to help not do a potential moratorium because of what we understand, what growth not keeping up with infrastructure. In the 17-507, on item B, there's 1, 2, and 3. And number 1 has to do with individual lots, half acre, and 2 is a more than half acre, and 3 would be what I would consider the minor and major subdivisions of development. So for considerations, I think items 1 and 2, if there's a way, if we were going to drop from 36 inches to 24 inches of fill, allowing less elevation, would we not penalize potential family petitions? I particularly am in a zone AE and have 4.5 acres and would like to see development. And I don't think an individual acre necessarily is causing the undue, unburdened management of our infrastructure. With our planning and zoning, we have those 10 guiding principles that we use. And number 1 is the protection of safety in our property. And number 2 has to do with managing growth. So I'm just wondering, because I'll speak on number 9 as well, if 8 is really about trying to manage growth and about protecting property, I would ask the consideration, if that is the true case, that you amend with the resolution that it just be for the minor and major subdivisions, which would be B, Section 3.
Thank you. Joe Moore.
Thank you, Chair and Council. My name is Joe Moore. I live at 11859 River Highlands Drive in Santa Maria, Louisiana. I'm here on behalf of the Ascension Board of Realtors, the builders, and all the realtors that do business in the parish. And I'm here to speak on their behalf opposing resolution item number 8 for the reason as follows. A 2-foot fill in areas A and AE would prevent most of those houses that would be built at a 2-foot level from getting a LOMA certificate to take that house out of the flood zone. which would drive the cost of that flood insurance from basically $500 or $600 a year to 5 to 10 times that amount. Because you have to have fill around a pier and beam structure on a LOMA certificate. So I would like you all to consider that and rewrap the resolution, and we would prefer to see it stay at 36 inches. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Jeff Pettit.
Good evening. One question is this. The first question is, why would we even consider setting a height standard, be it 2 feet or 3 feet? And 3 feet, I think, frankly, is ridiculous. Why would we even consider that until we have the floodplain management plan in hand, which I understand the RFQ has gone out for? So why would we arbitrarily set this? I mean, who came up with 2 feet or 3 feet? Who came up with either standard? I don't understand that. I don't see it. The rationale for it is not there to me. Maybe I'm missing something. I just heard the Realtor Association speak, and I can appreciate what they're trying to do. And but I've got to tell you this. Also heard Mr. Shin speak, and we've got those two state laws on the books that you cannot adversely affect your neighbor. The master subservient laws on the books, state laws, in the statutes. So I would say then no fill. Until we get this floodplain management plan back, and then we have a plan for the whole parish. What if you say 3 feet today and they come back and said, no, we need 4 feet? What if you say 2 feet and they say, no, you can't put any fill if that's the recommendation from the floodplain management plan? We're putting the cart before the horse. So I would ask you to rethink this and think about it seriously. My water's backing up on my property today, not as much as it did during the flood, because I didn't flood this time, but I've got three new developments right across the street from me, and you can't tell me it's not affecting my property. I've talked to Mr. Chereau about it, I've talked to Mr. Fournier about it, and they are concerned, and I hope they come out and they look at it with me. So I would ask you, why set an arbitrary standard without the floodplain management plan in place? So we're going to have to go back and change it again. Before you do that, do a total moratorium except for individual family residences. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, that's all the speakers that we had on this item. So just to bring everybody up to date, because we have this on the NOVA, the resolution, so it's at the council now. Councilman Lawler.
First of all, I'd like to say just a couple things on why I consider this something that's very important for us to consider right now. This is not about the right now. This is not about necessarily the citizens that are sitting here in Ascension Parish today. This is about the future. We have a serious problem with drainage and flooding in our future and presently. I'm not confident at this time that we are going to be able to get permits from the Corps of Engineers and to get our flood protection plans in place, and I'm talking levees, pump systems, everything to prevent future flooding in the short term. So what we need to do is find ways to protect our citizens from flooding in the immediacy. And part of that is there is an issue with fill. It's very simply put, that ideally you put no fill in a floodplain. That's ideally. However, from talking to people that build homes, that have placed trailers on property, it's not possible really to go in there and put a trailer on property without adding fill to the property. You have to be able to put some fill down, have a foundation to put your trailer down. I think this is very important for the future, because one of the things that we've seen in several districts, I've driven along Highway 42 up towards Port Vincent, and we have seen houses that the floor level is 6 feet higher than the people next to them, and it's all fill. And what that means is that the people that want to build, that are going to sell that property next to them, they're going to have to do the same thing. And if somebody down in San Juan decides they want to sell their 40 acres and develop it, and they want to build it up with 3 feet of fill, well, what does that do to the people around them? That's who we're trying to protect, is the people around, the people that are developing, the people that have lived in this parish for 40, 50, 60 years are having people build up around them and push water onto their property. And that's something that I think is unacceptable. We've seen that at past East Ascension drainage meetings. We had a gentleman come in whose nephew was building up 3 feet, and the water was going onto his property, and there's nothing we could do about it. And that's unacceptable to me. Now, this resolution explicitly provides an exception to all flood victims. And I think that's an important thing. I know there are several members on the council here tonight that is an important part of this resolution, and I believe it is, because I don't want to impede anybody from rebuilding their lives and their homes after this flood that we endured. Another part of this is, once again, the future. I'm looking at the future in pushing this resolution, because if we have another flood, we're going to have people that may have been flooded 2 and 3 times now, and they're not going to be able to get insurance. And the base flood elevations in this parish are probably going to move up. And if you've built your house on a slab, it's much more expensive to raise it than if you've built it on pier and piling. And what I'm looking at in the future is that we review our floodplain management system, and part of that is going to be, we're going to encourage people to build on pier and piling, get it up, and we can encourage them with financial incentives, you know, whether it be reduced permit fees or whatever, because we want people to get out of flooding dangers. That's what we're concerned about right now, is people flooding. And if we can help protect our future from that, that's going to increase our property values, because if we flood again, watch what happens to our property values. And when our property values go down, watch what happens to our school and our sheriffs and everybody that depends on property taxes for their funding. Because when all of that goes down, they get less money. And when they get less money, the quality of our schools go down. The quality of our law enforcement will go down. We'll still have the same amount of people here, but those qualities are going to go down, and our property taxes will fall down. I'm hearing voices. That's part of the concern here, is what's going to happen to our property values. Now, I look at many communities around South Louisiana, and in fact, all around the South, whether it's in Mississippi, Mandeville, Madisonville, down in Dulage area, they build on pier and pilings. They've got several beautiful houses in Ascension Parish built on pier and pilings, even a foot up with concrete lifters with beautiful brick around it. It can be done. It can be done efficiently, and it's something that we really need to move forward on. Now, what I'd like to do, though, is I'm going to move to make an amendment to this resolution to replace 24 inches everywhere it's mentioned in here, which is only twice in paragraph 1, to 12 inches.
Okay, so we have an amendment to the resolution to replace 24 inches with 12 inches in the resolution. Is there a second?
Could we get some input from Mr. Fournier?
Yes. Mr. Fournier, or on, perhaps. We've got three of them back.
Chairman, you didn't have a motion to begin with?
Well, we have a resolution.
Well, I'm happy to second the motion just to move.
Okay. So we have a second. We have a motion and a second. We have a motion to amend, and we have a motion to second. Seconding the amendment.
What, the 1 foot? There was no written motion. There's only an amendment on the table that's been seconded.
Doc made the motion.
You allow me to clarify from Robert's rules of order, because legal counsel and the secretary are confused, and perhaps that means other people are confused as well. There was no original motion to accept this resolution as it's in our package, per se. It was only Mr. Lawler's motion to amend the resolution that's in our package to read 1 foot,
correct?
Instead of 2 feet. That has now been seconded by Ms. Castro, and so we are in a discussion phase. That is what is on the table.
Yeah, that's what we said. It's the amendment that's on the table.
So help me to understand the difference between 24 inches and 12 inches and what the end pipe might be.
About this.
Well, I hear that.
Yeah.
Maybe that was a stupid question. I'm evaluating here whether I can support moving down. Does it make sense to move down?
Well, as was stated earlier, that right now the ordinance reads there are three sections of the drainage ordinance that's part of the Unified Land Development Code. In that portion of the ordinance, we're limited to 36 inches of fill on the three different categories. There's properties that are less than a half acre in size. They can only they're limited to 3 feet of fill right now. Properties that are over a half acre in size are limited to 3 feet of fill unless they provide us with an engineering plan that shows that how they're going to mitigate going up further than 36 inches, and that mitigation plan has to be prepared by an engineering firm. Then, as mentioned earlier, there are subdivisions, minor and major subdivisions, that are limited to 3 feet of fill unless they do an engineering study itself showing how they're going to mitigate the increase in fill above 36 inches and how they will retain that water on their site beyond that capacity. Beyond the 36 inches. I'm sorry. I have Sean Chereau here with CSRS, who's an engineering review agency, and Sean is the one who's been reviewing the drainage studies and can give us some technical engineering background behind that. So if there's some questions related to that, I'll let him talk. But in terms of going between 12 inches or 24 inches, it's a temporary measure. It's something that was looked at. How are we gonna limit this? I think the intent of this was not to exceed the 24 inches. Right now we have a couple of projects that are in review, and I think that they would basically comply with whether we go with a foot or 2 feet or 3 feet. Any project that's been approved in the past that's been approved by the Planning Commission would be exempt from this. They've already been approved. We can't go backwards on that. So we're kind of limiting it on that. Sean, I'd like to see if you might add something to that from an engineering perspective. Yeah.
Yes, I just wanted to comment. I believe on one of the, Jerome was right, there's three items when it comes to fill in the ordinance. One is lots, existing lots that aren't in subdivision that are half acre lots. They're maxed out 3 foot. And you can't extend that fill up to the property line. Second item in your ordinance is if you have...
Sean, could you get the microphone a little closer, brother?
Sure.
So everybody can hear.
The second item is if you have lots that are greater than half an acre. As long as you stay within the footprint of your building, you just like a small half acre lot. Just keep it under footprint of your building. It's very specific. Don't go more than 2 foot outside the edges. But if you want to fill higher, if you want to fill more, then you treat it like a subdivision. Or a commercial property, or a minor subdivision, to where you have to say, this is how much my property, within my property limits, holds water for a 100-year flood event. Quantify it, actually survey it. And then, they have to provide a plan that says, if I want to fill this much, now I got to find a way somewhere on my property to dig a hole, which we call detention ponds. More likely, it's always detention ponds, to equal to offset that additional fill that you placed on your property. So you can say, my property provided, I'm going to make up a number, 20,000 cubic yards before anybody did anything to it. Now, if you filled up and took 10,000 away, you got to find 10,000 depression somewhere on your property to offset that. So you can say, my property still provides the same amount of flood storage for a 100-year event that covered on that property than what it did before. And that's, when you use the word floodplain fill mitigation, that's what we're talking about. A lot of us that
may farm or work on property where you say, if I dig a hole, I got this much dirt, and I place it over here, it's the same. The confusion about detention ponds when we're coming by floodplain fill mitigation is you only get credit from where that water sits. We call it the normal pool, static pool, you know, the place that, you know, when your court finally hits the water, that normal elevation. From there up to where the existing ground was, that's the storage. That's the storage part of it. Now, most of us say, well, what about that stuff below the water? Well, that was just dirt. It does nothing for your floodplain storage credit. So I just wanted to clear that up on some people because I hear them say, how in the world can you that you say that pond is accounting for floodplain fill mitigation credit when the water sits in the pond? It's holding water. But it's not a part of the credit. It's only from where your water sits and goes up. So most engineers go, we go way too far in technical explanation there. So I hope I didn't confuse things too much. But I just know a lot of people are talking about the ponds and credits and stuff, but I just wanted to clear that part up.
Yeah. Question, Mr. Chairman?
Yes. Councilman Lambert.
Sean, yes, you had mentioned 100-year. The ponds are designed for 100-year storms. I wasn't aware of that. I thought we were still with the 25-year storm on the retention ponds.
When it comes to floodplain fill mitigation,
okay,
where you set that normal pool.
That's the
component I was talking about.
Like Ms. Johnson, you know, spoke earlier, minor and major subdivisions is where I feel we've taken a real hit on. Individual homes that we have plans with the half acres and larger, we get it engineered and make sure that it's not affecting our neighbors. You know, I'm okay with that. But your subdivisions that build up the complete floodplain, which we have done, and the ponds are supposed to handle it, and, you know, I just don't, the calculation, I know it's engineering, you know, I'm not an engineer to calculate, you know, that watershed, but to build up that many slabs, I've seen subdivisions that were built, and the subdivisions did not flood, you're correct, but everything around it flooded, and so apparently that water got displaced that was in that watershed more than what was calculated for.
Sure.
And that's a big issue that I have, especially going afoot. Afoot is, you know, and I'm okay with making some changes, but I don't think we need to do it for in the rural area where we can engineer that slab, just a slab only. We are engineering just a slab only, just a footprint. We're not going to a subdivision where we're filling the whole property in. It's more room for error, I think, when we fill the whole property of a watershed in than just a pad. I think just a pad, we can calculate it, and I think the engineering is a whole lot more simplified and can be done, you know. And if we're going to do anything, I think it needs to be minor and major subdivisions and leave rural residential homes like they are with the program that we have. Have we had any issues with that program, Mr. Jerome? I know several are going through the process now because of this flood. I personally have one that I know for sure.
We haven't had any necessarily with the individual lots.
Individual lots, right.
Yeah. Now, we have had some issues where the slope came a little too close to the property line.
But that should have been taken care of with the engineering.
That's exactly right, yeah.
And should have been corrected when we went out and inspected that. So
that's correct, yeah.
So we have to do it per engineered and inspected, right, and make sure it's done right.
And we've been talking to our building inspectors, so when they're going out right now and they're looking at, let's say, a slab framing on the house on a manufactured slope or elevated property, we're making them look at that now. Let's see how close they are to the property line, that type of thing.
So right.
We're becoming more and more aware of it as it's happening.
Yeah, but as it's written, I definitely don't want to go a foot across the board. That would be detrimental to a lot of homes that, you know, never received water on their property, and they are in these type of flood zones, you know. And
I think what you were talking about earlier about with the subdivisions, major and minor subdivisions, is that what's happening with the subdivisions, you know, prior to the subdivision coming out there and elevating, we had, before they were even built, we had a sheet flow.
Correct.
Thing.
That is correct.
So water would drain on another property, it'd fall on another property, it'd sheet flow onto what was then a vacant piece of property. we're working with DPW right now trying to clean out some of the servitudes that we have alongside some of the new subdivisions to eliminate the problem with that sheet flow stopping right now. So if we can go into a neighboring subdivision example, and we have several right now, where the servitudes are existing, we have an existing drainage servitude, they've never been needed before because the sheet flow kind of took care of the action, the water action. Now that the subdivision's there, we need to come out, clean out the drainage, and we're working with DPW on that right now.
So you plan on putting like swales or large ditches to stop this?
If that's needed, yeah. In many of those cases, we already have the servitude right. In order to do it.
And the big problem we're going to run into that, and what I experienced in the past, is servitude. I know we have the servitude, but most of them got fences in them servitudes. And they're going to have to come down, so it's going to be a cost to either the homeowner or, you know, because the fence has to be moved off the servitude for us to get these swales dug. And I agree, that's why we put these drainage servitudes down for a reason.
Absolutely.
That is a good point. I appreciate y'all looking into that.
Councilman Kluot.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just basically, you know, the way it's written tonight, I appreciate what Aaron's saying, that he's looking at trying to exempt the flood victims. But this started in strategic planning, and you know, in this basically strategic agenda here, that with you know this resolution in front of the other resolution. But the fact is, Jerome, you just got here, so you're not necessarily you know held liable for any of this. But the fact is, long before we had that flood in August, simple subdivision. I've got in my district somebody that has a simple subdivision, and they were recommended to go simple subdivision by their surveyor, okay, rather than go a family petition. They felt like they had more autonomy in that direction. They took something that looked like about 20 acres and built it the hell up, okay? I've been to the administration. I've been to everybody, all departments, and I'm being told that, well, we can't, and they're, matter of fact, their silt water, the clay water is running on everybody, all their neighbors, and been told that we can't do nothing with them until they come get a permit for a house.
Right.
Okay? That's the exact answer I'm told more than once. All right? I got another area that one neighbor's building up right to the line, almost like a wall. That's happened multiple times. You know, we've asked to serve papers or whatever, or try to get somebody to enforce the regulations. We can't get any enforcement, you know, or the laws that we have on hand. I'm for the individual homeowner, okay, and I'm for land rights, but you've got to be a good neighbor. So we have laws that we should be able to enforce, and apparently we can't. So either we got weak laws or wrong laws. This right here is, you know, how it initially came out of strategic planning is just a flat-out moratorium on any place with a fill is something I could never agree with. I still got hundreds of people out of the house. And like, you know, Mr. Lawler said, you can't even, you got to put some kind of pad to even get a brick to sit down straight. So no fill is ridiculous. And that's how it came out of that committee. All right. So, you know, working in the skirt to try to work something up. You know, we've got some absolution for the flood victims, but is this the right thing we're doing? And talking about we need a, you know, our floodplain study. We don't, you know, are we just going to make another law that we can't enforce? That's what I'm asking. And right here, the three foot. I guess Todd mentioned somebody I know. He and I both know that did get it engineered. You know, I have no problem with somebody building up because if you only build up a foot, you pour a concrete slab and then you build a house on top of it, you might as well have been 10 feet. It is what it is. So I have no problem staying within the footprint of the house. With some kind of regulation, all right? Or making sure that we just stay in the footprint of the house and not not filling up the whole 20 acres. Y'all have already addressed another concern I had, is that we can do the ponds all we want to take care of that square. But that sheet that used to go across it, it's got to go somewhere else. So either don't go, and that's what, you know, probably 50% of the time it don't go. And that burden's put right back on us to go ahead and try to do something with this 100 acres of land that water used to flow across that's not flowing across anymore. I still don't understand all the math of it. But this is not just a Sanamo problem. They got 100 subdivisions in the northern part of the parish that they dug big ponds and built up, okay? Well, they're not flooding. But we are. And I just do not want to stop the homeowners. I don't want to go all the way from the left to the right in one move. I don't have a problem with trying to work with some kind of moratorium or some hold up on the subdivisions, but on the individual homeowners, I want people to have some kind of rights on that. I just want it regulated. I want to know. We have people that have built, they call them the anthills, that go directly to the edge of their land. How'd they do it? They got permits, you know. There are no ditches around them. You know, we've had the Board of Adjustments let somebody come closer to the edge and different things like that. You know, so we've had subdivisions that weren't built out. I got a little small subdivision, took 20-something years to build out. That subdivision has houses on three different levels based on our FEMA floodplain adoptions, and of course, the final one in 2007. So you're going to have that stack look. So, you know, Mr. Lawler, I'm a yield to you. You said temporary. What do you anticipate saying that we didn't get anything done for a question 9 months ago? What do we anticipate now? What is temporary?
Well, first of all,
do you mind, Mr. Chairman?
No.
If I yield,
I believe the temporary is we are doing this in lieu of having a complete floodplain management plan, and that is what we actually need. We need a very good floodplain
management. No disagreement out of me on that.
No, and I think one of the issues is people building 3 foot up. Correct me if I'm wrong, but if you have a 100 by 240 foot lot, which is less than a half an acre, you can build up 3 feet right up next to your property, right up next to your neighbor, without an engineering plan. Correct?
Well, you can't flood your neighbor.
But no, that's don't
but
say
our
that.
Laws, but
that's
it happens all the time.
The map up.
But right now, if you have less than a half an acre and you got a 100 by 240 foot lot, you can put 3 feet of dirt on there and you can look at your neighbors and say, sorry, that's the problem that we have.
Well, are we misinterpreting the 3 foot rule that was put
well,
in?
Well, the 3 foot rule, I believe, is if you have less than a half an acre, you can put up to 3 feet, and then if you go above it, you have to get it engineered. But if you just go 3 feet, which is, that's a lot of dirt to put up next to your neighbor. Is that correct?
Man, I'm just going to read it right here. This is for individual lots, a lot smaller than a half an acre, which I believe we're talking about. No more than 3 foot of fill shall be placed in elevating structure. So we're correct on that one. Fill shall be limited to the foundation of the structure, shall not extend more than 2 foot or 24 inches horizontally beyond the limits of the foundation. Side slopes. So once you get to the 2 foot mark, you got to come down no steeper than 3:1. So basically, I call 3:1 is anything steeper than 3:1, you're not push mowing. You're getting the weed eater out. So something that's comfortable, you know, to mow around. Your fill shall not be placed closer than 10 feet to any property line in order to facilitate the collection and transportation of any increased runoff to the side yard or side yard swell. So it's in your ordinance. Basically, you can't touch your existing ground within 10 feet of adjacent property line.
Yeah, but that's flat. That's not a swale. That's not a ditch. It's nothing. That's just
right.
Flat.
Right. But
so right there, you can put. See, that's what's scary. That's about 10 feet, and you could probably start O'Neill at 3 feet, and slope down to Cinnamon, and then boom, and that's your name. That's that's the problem that we're having. And you can do that without getting any engineering done,
correct,
without flood protection, I mean, without holding the water on
that's
the
just,
land.
That's just a home builder placing some dirt to build a house.
Exactly. And the concern is that what about the homeowner next door? That's what I'm worried about. And that's why I think pier and piling, that's what we're heading towards. You know, ideally, we should have no fill in floodplain except for the plot, you know, where you're gonna put your pier and piling down. That's why I'm saying I think a foot is very reasonable, because people need to build. We want people to build. I can tell you, in my area, we got people building right along Camp Drive. They got it 8 feet up.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's not just in San Juan that they're building up. It's all over. But it's a long-term future thing.
Let me go to... You got one short...
I'll back real quick.
Okay.
I'll wrap up. I'll pass the mic. All right. I'm all right with the field under the home. My problem is building up whole lots, right, and making no improvements to drainage, right? And like I said, we got rules. I want to know how we're going to enforce what we got here now. Do we have to take another look at that or what?
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Councilman Satterley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have 4 points I'd like to make. Firstly, I guess I'm confused. First thing that I do notice is item number 8, which was added at the last minute to our agenda, is a resolution. Emphasis on that word. Albeit all resolutions are heavyweight, quote-unquote, suggestions. For example, like being resolved and asking someone to resign, supporting quick take expropriation, or even dedicating next Thursday, quote, John Smith Day, unquote, in Ascension Parish. None of these examples of resolutions, however, are, we know that, law. That is, a resolution has no real or meaningful force or effect, as was pointed out in the media just this morning. Number 2, Chairman Dawson has reportedly said, I think this, the 2-foot fill limit resolution before us, that's what he means by this, is a better solution than a general moratorium. 2 feet is the beginning point of a discussion, and the council may amend if they wish. I agree with Councilman Dawson, Chairman Dawson. 2 feet, and for that matter, 1 foot, or even the present 3 feet, in my opinion, are all arbitrary fill amounts to use as starting points at this point, no pun intended, until we finish. Important part of the item coming up next, a floodplain management study, which our drainage director says we need to have in order to enact an FMO, a floodplain management ordinance. Where is there, I'll ask anybody in this room who considers themselves or not experts, any metric or any data that the 2-foot mark would be helpful and be a solution to our flooding problems, temporarily or permanently? Number 3, according to Chairman Dawson's resolution that's in our packets, when I read it in detail, it calls for, quote, the administration to bring an ordinance by June 15 for introduction, unquote. He apparently therefore believes that it gives time to vet how the council may amend the resolution, and he stated so in the media. I thought Mr. Dawson and 5 of us, myself included, voted, quote, no confidence in Mr. Matassa's administration on March 16th. So will someone please tell me why we're asking for the assistance of the administration in, quote, bringing us an ordinance by June 15 for introduction into law? I think instead we should be doing our job as a council, which is developing ordinances, not the parish president. Number 4, I submit that our agenda was amended, swapping the original order of consideration of items number 9, the temporary moratorium on no fill, to be clear, and now number 8, the 2-foot fill resolution that's currently on the table, to its current reversed order in order to seek an affirmative vote on 2-foot or 3-foot or 1-foot or whatever it's going to be, rendering the moratorium recommendation by our strategic planning committee that I chair moot. In fact, I've seen this ploy, as we all have before, when we enacted traffic impact fees first to ward off a moratorium second that immediately followed an impact fee vote. Now, Mr. Shin has got up a minute ago
I captured something from what he said. Quote, you have to wait until number nine, he asked, should he talk about that? Chairman responded, comes up. Will it? Depending on what you do in eight, it may or may not. If eight passes. Ms. Johnson said, I'll be speaking on nine as well. Is she in the same boat as Mr. Shin? I don't know. The real estate agent came up here. I apologize for not capturing your name, sir. Said you were against number eight, at least the original one before Mr. Lawler's amended motion and wherever it's going to be going from now, because of your concerns in Loma, and I heard you, and I think they're legitimate. This is just yet then another reason why we should have a temporary, we should put that word always in here, moratorium. Doesn't even have to be 6 months, whatever. Depends on, I guess, how long we can take to get this floodplain management study and this ordinance done, okay, and established, which, by the way, speaking number four, it happened to be his point, Mr. Pettit. So I'm going to have a lot of trouble tonight, so I'll be on record right from the beginning, supporting an arbitrary alteration of Appendix 5, the three-foot rule, to make it two or one or wherever it's headed. I think what we need to do is get past this item, get on to number nine, decide if we're going to really do something meaningfully for the parish of Ascension. Thank you for listening.
Okay, Mr. Law.
Hold on, I do have your name. Mr. Moore, is that correct? What you had mentioned before about the Loma requirements and the fill, what is the basis for that? I'm curious, I'm not familiar with it.
Okay, there's a procedure in the federal regulations that allow you to apply for a Loma certificate. What that happens, you have to be 1 foot, your foundation of your house, and the adjoining property, 2 foot around it, has to be 1 foot above the 100-year floodplain, or you cannot exempt yourself from flood insurance. So let's take a typical flood insurance premium in this parish. Mine, for example, is $500 a year. I did a Loma certificate when I built it, the diversion. I did it to keep my insurance from going up to $2,500 a year. That same premium today, 9 years later, would be $5,500 on my house. If you do Pier and Beam, that's what you're going to be faced with. There will be people leaving this parish by the truckload to go to Livingston and adjoining parishes to build their big homes, because they will not be able to afford the mortgage, the hazard insurance, and this exorbitant money that's going to be leaving the parish and going to Washington. And we all know what happens in Washington. They don't do anything.
Now, if you would explain to me, is it simply because it's Pier and Beam?
No, you have to have a 2 feet perimeter, just like you do now on the so-called anthills. You have to have a 2 foot perimeter. The civil engineer just explained that earlier. Around the house, because your air conditioner and the foundation dirt around the slab, if you have a pier and beam, it goes straight down to the ground. You won't have any dirt, therefore you will not qualify for a Loma certificate that takes your foundation out of the floodplain. So instead of you having the normal flood zone X premium, which is very low, and even people that have houses that flooded, they're exempt too, because they're grandfathered in. But any new structure, pier and beam, chain wall, which are good ideas. I don't have any problem with that. I have a problem with the economic impact on the parish and the future homeowners and on the economic impact in this parish, which will be significant if this is adopted.
So if you would, I'm trying to educate myself. What were you saying, that we would need a certain amount of fill to raise the land up to a certain level? Is that fair?
Well, you will need higher than 2 feet in most cases. In flood zone area A and AE, you will need more than 2 feet. So even if you limited it to 2 feet, then those people are going to have to pay the higher premium. And that's going to be a big drain on this economy, huge, huge drain. There will be some people that can afford those higher premiums, but a lot of people will be forced to buy in these big subdivisions that you're talking about here tonight that will be exempted. So they'll go to the 20-acre and the 100-acre and the 500 acres until those lots are gone. And then what happens? Like it's happened in Livingston Parish already, there's no lots. The inventory of lots has been used up because in 8 years we had no subdivision development to speak of. So you have to look forward into the future. If you take this action tonight, where are you going to be in 3 or 4 years when the existing lot inventory dries up? It's a big concern.
And that's
the concern of the realtors, the builders, the lumber yards, the furniture stores. If you take 30% with most of these houses that we're talking about here tonight that will be affected by this 2-foot rule will not be built. That money's going to come out of your economy, because I've heard from all the builders, and I'm a commercial realtor that does big developments. I did the Bass Pro project in Denham. We have the same concern on commercial property, because it's going to affect commercial pad site development as well. You put a 2-foot rule in Ascension Parish, all the pad site development will come to a grinding halt. And I hate to say it, but they're all looking at joining parishes now, because they've been watching the media, they've been watching the news stories, and these people have to make these decisions a year in advance. So you've already scared off a significant number of developments for the parish, and it's going to have a major impact.
I certainly listened to our speakers. So at this point, I'm going to withdraw my proposed amendment, because I think we do need more consideration on this issue.
I agree.
But what my concern is we need to move quickly on the floodplain management plan.
The floodplain management is the key to finding a master solution to the problem. There is a major problem in this parish with drainage, sheep flow, all these issues that are brought to bear here tonight. And I do think that there are other places in the nation. I'll be glad to assist on that. My background is master planning and development. I did a lot of this work in Mississippi or in my earlier career. And there are solutions that I think will work here. And I think it's just a matter of coming up with the right plan and getting the right system in place to address a major, major problem.
Mr. Rue, may I ask you a question? I think you indicated that we have an RFQ out for the floodplain management plan.
It's being advertised.
Okay, great. Thank you. It's all questions I have.
Okay, so Councilman Lawler has requested to withdraw his amendment, and that was seconded by Councilwoman Kessler.
I have no objection.
Have no objection. Okay, so Councilman Satterley.
Yes, I would just like to address a comment before. I'm sure we're going to get another motion here in a moment. I'm not going to make it, but with all due respect, sir, I understand you're a real estate agent, and I know what you need to do, because I know how your bread is buttered. But you say that the economic impact of the moratorium would be terrible. I have to call a foul on that. We are something like, if you're not aware of it, I probably are, 7,000 to 10,000 rooftops in the pipeline in various stages of approval even as we speak. That's number one. Number two, and I got this information from former planning director Ricky Compton and others, because I looked it up on the internet. The American Planning Association, I spoke about this on my website, states doing studies of hundreds of counties in the states of Florida, Georgia, and elsewhere in the Southeast. The idea of rooftops and taxes versus the burden of infrastructure is one of a fallacy. I don't have the exact numbers in front of me, but I can get them and supply them. I recall for every rooftop that you add to your county, in our case parish, you can look to realize about $2.34 in tax revenues. But it's going to cost you in infrastructure, not just drainage, roads, sewer, law enforcement, the whole nine yards, right? Schools, $6 plus for the burden added in infrastructure. Now, I am not, for one final time, anti-growth. And I understand that that's inevitable, as people say, and it can be a good thing if managed. I think we can maybe all agree on that correctly. We're not managing it correctly, and that's why we're flooded, and that's why we're in nightmarish traffic jams. And so I support, let's take a deep breath. I don't think it's going to run a whole bunch of people off. It was said by the real estate agents and other developers in this parish, if we pass the green, I call it the green subdivision ordinance, which we did, saying that you've got to have trees in the front yard, in the backyard of a certain species, you've got to have sidewalks, you have to have a dedicated space for the children to play. It's going to run the cost up this many $1,000s, and it's going to really hurt how many people are going to come here. Wasn't even a hiccup. So I don't think that's going to happen, and I further believe that even if it did, there's nothing wrong with slowing growth right now while we try to figure this out, so at least the quality of life of the people here are not negatively impacted, particularly when the American Planning Association and other well-respected planning bodies have said that the amount of money it's needed for the infrastructure for every rooftop brought in is a 3-to-1 proposition. Again, I thank everyone for listening.
Councilman Kluwer.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to make a substitute motion that we defer this back to Major Drainage and DPW for the study.
Making a motion that we commit that we commit this to the administration.
Yes.
And have them send this to Drainage and DPW for further consideration and modification of the floodplain ordinance. Is that correct?
That is correct.
I'll second that.
Sir. Have a motion and a second to commit this back to the administration for further study and development of a modification to the floodplain ordinances. Any discussion, any questions? Any opposition?
Object.
I have one objection, Madam Secretary.
Councilman Satterley.
No.
Councilman Kluwer.
Yes.
Councilman Joseph.
He's not here.
Yes.
Oh, he is.
Councilman Lawler.
Yes.
Councilwoman Casso.
Yes.
Councilman Lambert.
Yes.
Councilman Cagnolotti.
Yes.
Councilman Johnson.
Yes.
Chairman Dawson.
Yes. Okay. The motion is committed back to the administration. Item number 9, we have a recommendation from the Strategic Planning Committee. Consideration of a temporary moratorium on development that requires fill. And then this was Councilman Lawler, I think, his motion in strategic planning. Is that correct?
I think Councilman Lawler and Satterley, the two of us.
Okay. So who wants to handle it?
Well, I mean, Aaron, why don't you go ahead? You the one that requested it there. You're the one that spoke most on it. All I did was second the motion, as I did also for Mr. Dawson, who didn't want to do that night, but for a different reason. He never said he was against the fill ordinance.
Right.
And as everyone knows, a second just means that you want to hear more discussion. So I certainly would like to hear more discussion this evening.
Once again, I brought this for the same reasons as we talked about the fill before. It sounds like we need some time to think on this and plan on this because it is much more complicated. Not than we thought. We knew it was complicated, actually, quite honestly, so we've talked about it. I think a pause construction that needs fill is warranted. I would certainly not want to include
Councilman.
Sure.
My good vice chair reminded me that we had speakers, and I apologize for that, so we need to move into the speakers for this. So first, Charlotte Johnson, item number 9.
Well, thank you again, District 2. And let me just say, this was very painful to listen to and watch. Item number 8, and now moving to item number 9. And, as leaders, I think it's very important that we understand the things that we bring before this council for vote and consideration, whether it's a resolution or an ordinance for law, that there is due diligence that is necessary to go into it. I think I probably did more studying today about the ordinance and had my copy than Councilman Lawler did. I mean, I wanted to bring my thing up to you. So I'm all for growth. I love our parish. I love where we're going. I love what we do. But frankly, our growth has exceeded our infrastructure. Mr. Lawler, I was your future 30 years ago. I was a 20-year-old bride that came to Ascension Parish and built a home. That I don't want to live at Lake Johnson. It's not meant to be Lake Johnson. And so what we need is a master flood plan management thing that says where we can do our watershed. I have a neighbor who has turtle-backed 7.5 acres that causes to me be the way I am. And could it have been the good old boy politics of Ascension Parish that has landed this property owner in the situation that she is in? Or is it the mass construction all around that flows the water down Hodgson Road into Conway, Bayou Bull, Panama, that it's the maintenance that has not happened with drainage? So I don't know really if I'm for a moratorium or not for a moratorium, because at this moment, I have very little confidence in what I'm hearing and seeing. Very disturbed about the amount of discussion or lack of education. I appreciate the realtor talking about, hey, do you understand the unintended consequences if you don't use 36 inches because you're going to raise the flood insurance? I've had flood insurance for 20 years. I'm on Lake Johnson. I've been very fortunate that my home did not flood even. I know Councilman Dawson was so surprised, like, Charla, you didn't flood. This is like a miracle. It's true. But I don't want any more challenges associated with not being able to afford the flood insurance that I already have. So I think there needs to be real consideration from the councilmen that are up there and due diligence before you just willy-nilly vote on something or bring a resolution. I'm just really concerned, and make sure that what you're proposing there, that the citizens all remember the top two principles, the protection and safety of our property and to manage growth. So if number nine, if there needs to be a temporary moratorium so that we can understand where our drainage is going and our infrastructure needs to be kept up, then that's what needs to happen for the future that was here with you 30 years ago. I have 23 and 25-year-old children who want to stay and live in this parish. They're having problems finding affordable places. They say, Mom, we want to live on the land. I'm like, wow, okay, but what does this mean? Do you really want to live in Lake Johnson? You know, so think about what you're doing, because I wasn't Lake Johnson 30 years ago.
Thank you, Sean. Mr. Moore.
I addressed my comments earlier on number eight. The only thing I have to add on number nine is that I think a temporary moratorium at this time without further study would be detrimental to the parish growth. And I just returned from a convention in Las Vegas where all the commercial developers from around the world meet once a year. And this was the busiest year I've ever seen. Most of these people are already looking at sites for the past year or two, and they're making decisions in July and August of this year on what they will do here in this parish for the next 2 years. So before you implement a moratorium, you need to consider that.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Shin.
As Ms. Johnson just said, she has children that have bought, buying, moving, and want to stay in this area too. I do too. My daughter recently bought a house across the street from me. We're in flood zone X. We don't flood, supposedly. I got flood insurance in March because another subdivision is going in around me. The water got within 20 feet of going in my daughter's house in flood zone X in the fall when we had the big rain. I'll just call it that. We have drainage problems as it is. It gets worse every month. Why it gets worse every month, I don't know. This, it does. We're on... my street is all on septic system, and now it goes to not only having poor drainage, but also having poor use of your facilities and your inside facilities. We'd be better off sometimes if we had outhouses, because at least we'd still have some place to go when the water isn't draining. But now, sometimes now we go a day at a time, so we go get a hotel room, because the infrastructure has failed us. You know, he says this about houses, you know, being built on piers and everything else. You look around the country, Louisiana's not privy to lowlands, okay? We're not the sole proprietor of having swamp. They have the same thing in Florida. And they're avoiding the same thing in Houston that we are trying to avoid by stepping up everybody's lots. I have friends in Katy. When they bought their house, they never had an issue about flood, but now they're having to get flood insurance, and they're not in a flood zone. This is what we're trying to avoid. We want our homes in Ascension Parish, not the new homes. This is everybody that's been here forever. We want our homes to be safe, too, and they're not. We have just as high a risk of having flood now as a person over here in A and AE does routinely, and we shouldn't in an X area. We didn't. 15 years ago, we never had a problem. Never. The last 5 years, it's got even worse. I know. I hear you. My time's up. But trust me. If you build a house on piers or you build them up, people will still come. And, yeah, they'll have to buy flood insurance. And, damn it, I had to buy it, too. And I'm not in a flood zone.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Shin. We're back to Councilman Lawler.
Yeah, I'm looking at my notes. What I'm concerned about, and I hear everything that's been said, a lady in my district, Dawn Adamall, she's got subdivisions all around her, and she constantly now has water 6, 12 inches on her land, all around her house, all the time now. What I'm concerned is, what if we build a subdivision? What if we authorize a subdivision and tell them that they can use 4 feet of fill, and they start doing that, and then we have our floodplain management plan come back and says, well, you know what, where they're building that subdivision, they really shouldn't use any fill. So from now on, nobody can use fill there. I don't see why we're going to allow that right now. I think we should take the time, look at what we're doing, get a plan together, because we can't go back. They put the 4 feet of fill on there, and we're stuck with it, and then those property owners around it are going to be 4 feet below that property owner after that. Because we didn't say, hey, you know what, let's take a pause and make sure we're doing things right. Now, I've heard all the concerns about developers won't build, but if you remember when we did the traffic impact study, we had people come and saying it was going to kill development, it would never happen. And we have continued to grow. And we had people telling us that you're not going to build another subdivision with these traffic impact study fees, well, you can only cry wolf so many times. What I'm proposing is a 3-month moratorium on large and small subdivisions only, excluding any flood victim. And it'd be a moratorium on using fill. I guess you could say it's more of a prohibition against using fill for large and small subdivisions for a 3-month period. I don't believe that would affect any person that was flooded, because any person that's flooded is not going to be building a complete subdivision. So that's the motion that I am presenting. It'd be limited to 3 months, and I hope in that time we can come back with a floodplain management plan. It would be tied to that. If we come back with a floodplain management plan before 3 months, the moratorium is lifted, and we can move forward and start building. But I'll be quite honest, 3 months is a very short period of time. It's during the school year. It's a time when school is not in, so they can't do traffic studies to see whether or not the subdivisions are going to affect traffic. So I don't think it would really be stopping growth. It would be giving us some time that we can make sure that we're going to make the right decision and not allow something to go wrong that we can't fix later on. We have to make some tough decisions, and this may be one of them.
Let me make sure that I have your motion correct, which is that you are... You're moving that we have a 3-month moratorium on placing fill. Is that what you...
Correct.
On placing fill in large and small subdivisions up to 12 inches. Is that correct?
That is correct. I can do that. Large, 12 inches. And that would be large and small subdivisions as defined by 17507B and C.
Can I ask Mr. Parrington, since we have an ordinance that regulates that.
You have to pass an ordinance. You can't do anything by motion or by resolution. You must pass an ordinance. You have to introduce and then have an ordinance just like you would any other ordinance.
Okay. So we, you know, in this, did you get that, Mr. Lawler?
Yes.
So, do you have a, substitute motion, or do you have a?
Well, at this point, if I understand correctly, we can only introduce it.
You've got to introduce it at the next meeting.
At the next meeting. So, I mean, there's nothing that we can do at this point, even based on the moratorium that we have on the agenda. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So then, put it this way, that is my intent then, so at the next meeting, to propose a moratorium on using fill in large and small subdivisions to extend for 3 months or upon the completion of a floodplain management plan, whichever is least. My children are going to kill me. That's my intent.
Is to bring an ordinance to introduce an amendment to the ordinance to be introduced at the next meeting. Is that correct?
Correct. It's my understanding that even with this moratorium on the agenda, there's nothing we can do.
So there's no action required tonight.
No, we don't have to take any action.
So we will. I think we will have some discussion. This is a kind of important topic. Councilman Satterley.
Yeah, I'm curious about the 3 months, because out of committee discussion was more along 6 months, based on the fact that Mr. Rue, who indicated tonight that we've begun the process now, post the HNTB meeting of going out for RFQs, and that it would take, in their timeline, even though they're not the one that has the job, they may get it, may not. Yeah, I believe it's 6 or 7 months. Can we get a floodplain management plan? And actually, I'd like to see Mr. Lawler's ordinance go further. The plan is one thing, and an ordinance, as Mr. Parrington has indicated, is another. FMP and FMO enacted in 3 months. Or is that a pipe dream? Would you care to comment on that, Mr. Rue? Could you come to the microphone? Thank you.
You're looking at end of the month is when we're planning on meeting with the committee to choose an engineering firm for this. You're looking at best another, depending on what engineering firm, another at least 2 to 3 weeks to negotiate the contract and get the contract approved. So now you're looking at close to 2 months. Best case scenario, you could tighten up the timeline on the study itself to maybe 3 to 4 months, possibly.
So we're back to six.
Now, so you're looking at the end of the year, you know, close to it before you could hope for getting something substantial for us, a recommendation for an ordinance and some kind of outline of a plan. There's no way you get a full-blown plan, but you may be able to get some portions of that plan, you know, by the end of the year.
Thank you.
Is it not true, Mr. Rue, that in the HNTB plan that was, it's a proper term, scuttled, had 30-some-odd steps, like 38, and number 32 was the actual recommendation of ordinances?
So this motion that's on the table
includes, until the FMP is completed, mm-hmm. You've just indicated it's going to take 5 or 6 months. Mm-hmm. But is that just to the plan or all the way through ordinance recommendation?
No, that's just to probably the recommendation of the administration and the engineering firm as to the outline, if at best, outline of the plan with some suggestions of the possible ordinance and stuff like this. Because, again, when you get through this, you're going to be going through a lot of conversation we're going through right now on their recommendations and where they get the data from, and people going to have different opinions and things like
because
this.
I can
so
understand
that's going to take a while to get
right.
Everybody to agree, let's do this ordinance. So
I can understand compromise and going to 3 months to get a moratorium at all, but six. Mm-hmm. But if that's a waste of time, why even do that? I mean, you clearly indicated that there's no way we're going to have an FMP or, for that matter, an FMO in a three-month period of time. So I would ask Mr. Lawler to consider that.
And the reason I stated 3 months is we can then look at it and renew it at that point. You know, I know it will take longer, but I'm hoping that spurs us to move pretty quickly on it, and we can always renew it at a three-month period.
You could have a more in-depth conversation on what's a realistic time to get to the actual ordinance and things like this. You know, you'd be far enough into it to give you a better timeline, I could say. You know.
So let's remember this, that you know, we're not taking any action tonight on this, that this right. this is simply Mr. Lawler's thoughts on how he would proceed with the ordinance. Any further discussion?
Yes.
Councilman
Real quick,
Kulak.
I need a clarification. Mr. Rule or Mr. Fournier can either clarify. Aaron, with respect that you said on you wanted the moratorium on large and small subdivisions.
That's correct.
Can we get a clarification? Is simple subdivision of land included as a small subdivision, and is family petitions included?
Family petitions would very likely be excluded from that.
Right.
Subdivision is typically defined as 10 or more lots. Right.
So
if we have anything less than nine lots,
simple
we can
subdivision
do
of land of up to 5 lots to 7
yeah.
lots
right.
would not even fall under this.
Right. That would not be considered a subdivision.
Right. I just wanted a clarification. Yeah. So what do you call a small? We use the terms. We may just be using lay terms of large and small.
That's why I defined it by 17507B and C, where
B
it's defined
C.
in there.
Okay.
Right.
Okay, so we established the definition on that. That's how I got it written, what you said.
Okay. Any further discussion, any further questions? So tonight we have no action on item number 9. Item number 10, resolution to encourage administration to accept and implement the recommendations made by SSA consultants regarding efficiency and effectiveness. And the resolution was in your packet. So generally speaking, I'll just go to the be it resolved, the Ascension Parish Governing Authority requests the administration to provide quarterly updates to the Finance Committee beginning 3 months from the passage of this resolution and continuing until either implementation is complete or the council no longer desires the updates. We're looking for a motion.
Motion to
adopt this resolution, Councilman Joseph, seconded by Councilwoman Castle. Discussion, Councilman Kluot.
Real quick, I would just like the administration, as we had conversation before, go back to the consulting group. And as the presentation that they had shown, and they'd shown the numbers in different departments, say drainage and DPW, that you get some clarifications back to the council on being the two major groups of people we expect to try to keep the parish up, the roads, the drains, the ditches and all, that we actually get the breakdown down to the working employees, okay? Yeah, we know that's going to include a certain percentage of administration, a certain percentage of staff and all, because, you know, we're looking for the people doing the work. And then if those people in those departments need more help, I know we've authorized some more hires and through East Central Drainage Gravity District number one. But if those departments need more help, we don't necessarily need the public to think that we got like 85 people out there doing something when we got 85 people in the department. And I don't believe it was misleading at a point. I think it can be misconceived. All right. Thank you.
Mr. Dawson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We will get that clarification, and so that there's not any misunderstanding of how what work's being applied, you know, people out there doing the work compared to other issues. We'll get that for you. The second thing is I want to say is that We are continuing, President Matas has kind of told us to move forward with implementation. We've already started that. Even the recommendations for the effectiveness study that was done at the special finance committee meeting. Secondly, the goal is, he also wanted us to do even more frequent updates than quarterly. The goal is that there will be some sort of an update that you will be getting at your finance committee meetings as to how we continue to move forward. As SSA stated, some type of dashboard that it would be easy for the council to establish where we are and what we're doing. That's what we're working on, and that's what we continue to do. I have a meeting scheduled with them on Tuesday morning to continue to move this forward. So, point well taken, and the president has already instructed me to move forward with that, and we are doing so. Thank you.
Okay. Any further questions? Any further discussion?
I have a question.
Question, Councilman Sadler.
My question in the third, whereas, Mr. Chairman, states that there were additional requirements in both the presentation and the long-form narrative. I've never seen a long-form narrative. Is that forthcoming, and if so, when? Can someone tell us when?
There was I copied this out of the presentation, so there are these, I think, four or five additional recommendations that were in that presentation, and that's what they...
Is that what you're referring to? I remember Ms. Slaughter said that we're going to get...
There is some more detail coming on these recommendations, is my understanding.
And when will we have that?
Mr. Dawson.
We are waiting, SSA. I think the last time I talked with Dr. Slaughter was this week. She said they were going through the final draft of it, and it should be coming to you, very soon. I will have a definite date after I meet with her on Tuesday.
Okay.
And I could email that to everyone.
And Mr. Chairman, if I will, the reason I ask is that maybe the resolution would be incomplete based on what is stated in that narrative. Maybe in addition to the 11 points made in the second whereas, I guess, we would want to include other things that they may not have mentioned in their slide presentation.
Are you proposing an amendment to the resolution?
Well, I'm just asking you, is that possible, that could occur? Because we vote on this tonight. We haven't seen what I'm calling the long-form narrative, which...
Look, if you'd like to propose an amendment which would say... Well, I think what we've got is we have the commitment from the administration that says they're going to implement all the recommendations of the SSA schedule, whether they come in a long form, short form, or 1048. That's going to, is that correct? Now, I'm open to an amendment to the resolution if you'd like to have that.
Well, I wouldn't even know how to amend it because I haven't seen this narrative. My question remains. It would seem to me that if we have a commitment and we trust, quote, the administration, that in quotes, do we need to proceed right now with a resolution that may be incomplete when we don't know all the recommendations that Ms. Slaughter's group is going to make by virtue that we just don't have the narrative?
Dr. Slaughter that it's not... There's more clarifications on the recommendations that are already presented in the slide presentation. It's not any additional recommendations, but just clarification of the ones that are already presented to the Finance Committee.
Well, I would offer this, Councilman Satterley. We can always make another resolution if additional recommendations.
As I said earlier, it has no weight of law anyway, but I'm just I'm curious. Yeah. I seem to be in a hurry to do this, and the administration said they're going to do it anyway. But, okay.
Okay. Any further discussion? Any further questions? Any opposition? Resolution is adopted. Item number 11, approval of substantial completion of Lamar Dixon Expo Center, 4-H building, barn 7, concrete slab, Mr. Matassa and Mr. Rogers.
We just finished that little project, and we did it for several reasons, and Mr. Rogers is here, but we did it to help the 4-H and also for other events that he can use the buildings for, and it's substantial completed, so that's where we're at. Anything you want to add to that?
Any questions for Mr. Roger, Mr. Lambert?
All in the budget? Met the budget? Okay.
Yes, sir, no.
Make that motion.
Second.
A motion by Councilman Lambert, second by Councilman Kluot. I have a question, Councilman Kluot.
Yeah, Kyle and Kenny, as we looked at this last year, and one of the things that we have, based on the amount of time and effort we put into the 4-H building, and also the LSU folks will agree that as we put that change in place, put that cover and do everything there, that's going to allow them a better place for certain livestock.
Absolutely. Give us a spot to house those animals outside that air-conditioned building. Also, I can't get over the amount of attention it's getting from company picnics, from small festivals, outdoor concerts. I mean, this was a diamond in the rough. This was a great investment.
But it came as planned, so
absolutely.
We appreciate that. Thank you.
You know, just to let y'all know, you know, we have increased a lot of events out there, and we talk about giving employees to areas that need them. Well, we got 20 part-time workers that's going to work events, and another 20, so it'll be like 40 part-time workers when he needs them. Now, I know it looks bad on the books for 40 more employees, but that's what he needs. Now, if he only needs 3 for this weekend, he gets 3 out of the 40, but you follow me? So we're giving the departments what they need to do their job.
Thank you. First, Councilman Lawler.
Not really on this topic, but Lamar Dixon, I mean, how's it doing financially, bookings? Give us a little update, kind of where we are this year, maybe compared to last.
Oh, we're blowing the doors off of it.
Is that technical? we may have to fix that. It's going to be a change order, I think.
That's technical. No, it's outstanding, absolutely outstanding. I can tell you on the books right now, if we didn't bring in another event, just what we have booked, we have over $800,000 in event revenue, and that's just event revenue. The most Lamar Dixon has ever done in a single year is 425. So that's pretty strong. Right now, we're trying to identify parts of our calendar that we can kind of earmark to do housekeeping, to put things back together. You know, you have a party at your house. Sometimes you need a day or two to get everything back together, make sure the lamps that are broken are replaced and things like that. But, you know, it's been amazing, amazing year for us so far.
Councilman Joseph.
Yeah, Kyle, I mean, once again, you know, for all the success you're having over there, but can I see that on paper?
Absolutely.
Okay, can you email me that something?
Sure.
I mean, or give that to the finance. I mean, a while back, we used to get a report there. I know Councilman Lambert over there know that. We used to get a real good report on what mm-hmm. events, what type of events, so we can look at and see where the money is actually being generated from.
I'd love to. It's a great story to tell.
All right. So if you can do that, the next quarter, that finance report that you report to us, be greatly appreciated.
Sure. Right.
And
further comments or questions? Parish President?
What I would like to do at finance meetings, after he can be the first one, then after that, each one of our areas give a report to your finance.
Okay?
We'd be happy to have them, sir.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second to approve the substantial completion. Any objections? Motion carries. Item number 12, approval of substantual completion. Lamar Dixon, Expo Center. A motion by Councilman Kluot, second by Councilman Lawler. Any discussion? Any opposition? Motion carries. We'll have introduction of ordinances. The item number 13, introduction of ordinance to amend and revise Ascension Parish Unified Land Development Code pertaining to subdivision construction specifications.
Motion to introduce.
Motion.
Second.
Councilwoman Castro, second by Councilman Joseph to introduce. Any opposition? Motion. The ordinance is introduced. Item number 14, introduction of ordinance providing for the incurring of debt and issuance of not to exceed $25 million aggregate principal amount of Parish of Ascension, State of Louisiana revenue bonds for the purpose of funding the cost of constructing, maintaining, and improving roads. The project within sales tax district number 2 of the Parish of Ascension, Louisiana. The district funding a debt service reserve fund if necessary and paying the cost of issuing the bonds in one or more series, prescribing the form, term, conditions of the bonds, and in security thereof, designating the date, denomination, and place of payment of such bonds, providing for the payment of such bonds, and the principal interest, proving, confirming the sale of such bonds, and providing for other matters with respect to the bonds. This is a move, these are the move ascension bonds.
Motion.
I have a motion by Councilman Lawler, second by Councilwoman Casso. Is there any discussion? No. Was it Cagnolotti? Sorry. Y'all look alike.
I have the same head.
Sorry, Terry. Sorry. Any?
We have the same hair.
Any discussion? Any opposition? Ordinance is introduced. Public hearings. Reading of ordinance to adopt the updated transportation impact fee schedule and map. Mr. Parrington.
To amend Chapter 19, Roads, Bridges, and Other Public Ways, Article 4, Transportation Impact Fee of the Ascension Parish Code of Ordinances, where Ascension Parish seems to be one of the fastest growing parishes within the state of Louisiana, where this rapid growth has negatively impacted the capacity of transportation network within Ascension Parish, where the desire of citizens of Ascension Parish to provide adequate road capacity as one component of the quality of life enjoyed by the citizens of the parish. Whereas the parish of Ascension has determined that the best interest of citizens of Ascension Parish to establish transportation impact fees to assist in the mitigation of transportation impact of the rapid growth of transportation network within Ascension Parish. Whereas on March 17, 2017, Duncan and Associates completed a transportation impact fee study for the parish of Ascension, Louisiana. Whereas the above study used a consumption-based model which is supposed to charge a net development cost of replacing the capacity that it consumes on the major roadway and system. Whereas now Ascension Parish decides to amend the transportation impact fee ordinance based on the study above, where now therefore be it ordained that Ascension Parish governing authority of the parish of Ascension, Chapter 19, Article 4, transportation impact fee be amended and further described as Exhibit A attached to and made a part hereof. If any section, subsection, sentence, clause, phrase, or portion of this ordinance is for any reason held invalid or unconstitutional by any court of any competent jurisdiction, competent state or federal agency or competent jurisdiction, such portion shall be deemed separate, distinct, and in the provision of such holdings shall not affect the validity of any portions of the hereof. The ordinance shall be effective as permitted by law. The ordinance has been submitted to a vote. The vote thereon was as follows.
Public hearing. Motion by Councilman Cagnolotti to open the public hearing. Second by Councilman Joseph. Any opposition?
Motion to close.
A motion by Councilman Joseph. Second by Councilman Kluwat to close the public hearing. Any objection?
Motion.
Public hearing closed. The ordinance to adopt the updated transportation impact fee schedule and map.
Motion accept.
I have a motion to adopt by Councilman Joseph, a second by Councilman Kluwat. I'm gonna get to you. I have an amendment to this ordinance. I have a proposed amendment to the ordinance, which is to replace under 19-51B fee updates to replace paragraph 1 with beginning in 2018, the fees in the transportation fee schedule shall be adjusted on the first day of each July based on the percentage average change in the Engineering News Record Construction Cost Index from the preceding two calendar years for fiscal year 2018 and on each subsequent July 1st for the fiscal year commencing. The transportation impact fee administrator shall present the proposed fee change to the parish council before June of each year. This, just a note that we had the CPI, same CPI in here before, but the wording was a little bit confusing, so it was changed. So I'm looking for a motion to adopt the amendment.
Motion to adopt as amended.
A motion to adopt as amended. Well, second. We have to adopt the amendment first. So a motion to adopt the amendment. Councilman Kluwat, second by Councilman Lawler. Any discussion? Any opposition? The amendment is adopted. Now, we're back to the main motion as amended. So we need a motion to adopt the ordinance as Councilman Cagnolotti. A motion to adopt.
Second.
Councilwoman Casso is a second. So we have a motion and a second to adopt the ordinance. Any discussion? Councilman Satterley.
Yes. As I indicated last council meeting when this item was introduced, but unfortunately I don't have the same information in my packet as I had then, and I thought it would be there. Under the fee schedule, which I believe is under the current packet information on page 13 of 20, land use types listed are 25. And what I don't have from last time is, but I'm going to go with that, assuming nothing's changed. I believe it was 14, I indicated, of the 25 I counted, resulted in negative numbers. What do I mean about that? If we adopt for the East Bank a 70% levy of Duncan's recommendations for those 25 land use types listed in that fee schedule table, that will result in 14 of 25 of them being negative numbers. What does that mean? We would thus be charging less than we have been charging during the last calendar year, or the last year to date, to developers for the impact fees in this parish. Said another way, I don't understand, and unless I can understand it, I continue to have little appreciation for paying for, you know, large amounts of taxpayer dollars again for an outside expert company, Duncan's and Associates, to come in and do not only originally have done the impact fee study, but then to tell us we need to adjust it to these amounts, but then we arbitrarily, word been used a lot tonight, decide that, well, we're going to ignore that recommendation and just charge 70% for the East Bank and 35% for the West Bank of what that company recommends. So I seek at least an explanation, and actually, unless it's a real good one, I would make a substitute motion that we just accept the recommendations of, as far as fee schedule is concerned, of Duncan at the full base fee 100% amount. After all, that is the just amount that an independent company expert in this area came in and has advised this council is what you should charge. And it also relates to the issue that was just amended about, you know, not having to pay them to do this again by having language in there, which I greatly appreciate and approve of, that we don't have to do that because it'll automatically adjust every year. But now it'll be automatically adjusting to 70% on the East Bank levy of the base as opposed to 100%. So we will be behind literally forever. So I'm just wondering, I know it came out of transportation in terms of discussion that way, although I did remember I was there in the audience that night in the meeting. I thought it was coming back to transportation. At least that was what I heard said. Instead, it came directly here. It was introduced last time, and now we're about to vote this into law. I'd like to see a base fee of 100%.
So let me make sure I have that correct. You're proposing an amendment to the ordinance that would replace the 70% and the 35% with 100%. Is that correct?
On the East Bank levy, which I'm interested in, my motion with amended motion would be to change the base fee from 70% levy to 100%. I have no problem with the West Bank being 35%. After all, one of the things that we did learn, here's my reasoning there, in the first 11 months, the last time numbers were given to this council, I believe for the three different zones, 1, 2, and 3, 1 being pretty much up in Prairieville, where Councilwoman Casso, Councilman Lawler, and myself hold court, and a little bit south of that, other councilmen affected as well. It was like 1.2 million, maybe a half a million in Zone 2, which was still in the East Bank, but south of the Prairieville area. And then on the West Bank, it was a matter of a few tens of a thousand. I think we were told that there was actually only one or two projects, and Councilman Joseph has indicated they haven't built a subdivision of the West Bank since 1973 anyway. So I have no problem trying to give them a break, and when I say give them a break, to stimulate, because they don't have the growth problem we have on the east side of the river. So my motion would be for base fee 100% East Bank levy.
Okay. So we have a motion to amend the ordinance to change the 100% levy to change the 70% levy to 100%. No, here a second. Have no second. Motion dies. We go back to the. We have a motion to adopt. Further discussion, Councilman.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I kind of see it a little bit opposite of Mr. Sally. I would like to see the East Bank drop to a 60% because of the hardships that the people experienced this year with the flooding, and if we're going to look at it every year.
The West Bank is at 35, we at 70. I would like to make a substitute motion that we drop it to 60%, being we have the hardships that we do this year.
Do we have a motion by Councilman Lambert to amend the ordinance and replace 70% of the levy with 60%?
On the East Bank.
Yeah, that's the only place that it has to.
I'll second that.
I have a second by Councilman Kluot. So do we have further discussion? Councilman Satterley.
Yeah, I really think we're seriously gone, and with all due respect, in the wrong direction here. I thought this impact fee ordinance was once again primarily aimed at the, had a lot of discussion tonight of what's a large and a small, whatever, subdivisions, not private homeowners are having hardship problems. And my intention is not to hurt them and try to help them as much as you can. But on the other hand, if you're building a new house, period, be it in a large subdivision, smaller, just one and so forth, versus your replacement home, perhaps we could have an exemption if that's the concern of everyone else. But we need to be doing something that's consistent with what the professionals have recommended that we need to do.
Okay. Councilman Lawler.
I think there may be some misunderstanding of these impact fees. They're not going to apply to anybody that was flooded if they're rebuilding their homes.
That's what I heard of transportation as well.
Yes, unless they're building a home larger than what they had before. And it would have to be, in most cases, significantly larger, meaning spending tens of thousands of dollars. The increase would be at most $200. Maybe there's a misunderstanding of it. So there's really there's no real benefit to protecting anybody that's been flooded or lowering it, other than we're going to have less money going to our roads. I don't see the logic in that. I'd offer a substitute motion then to raise it up to 80% for the east bank service.
What's the zone? I don't know.
East service area.
So are you offering?
I'm offering a substitute motion to make it 80%. I thought we were good at 70 before.
I'll second it.
A motion to change the 70% to 80%. So we have a motion and a second. Any discussion on the move from 70 to 80%? Any opposition?
Object.
Have opposition. Mm-hmm. Roll call, Madam Secretary. This is to change the east side zone from 70% to 80%.
Councilman Satterley.
Yes.
Councilman Kluot.
No.
Councilman Joseph.
No.
Councilman Lawler.
Yes.
Councilwoman Casso.
Yes.
Councilman Lambert.
No.
Councilman Cagnolotti.
No.
Councilman Johnson.
No.
Chairman Dawson.
No. Result, please.
6 nays, 3 yeas.
Motion fails. Now we're to the motion to... I forgot.
70%.
back to the original. We're at the original motion.
The
60. That's right. Well, that's what I thought. We're on the motion at 60% to change the 70 to 60. Motion by Councilman Lambert. Any discussion?
Did anyone?
Councilman Johnson.
Anybody second that?
Yeah. I don't know if Mr. Parrington or anybody else can answer this. Can we legally charge residents different rates within this ordinance?
As far as different zones, yes. Yes. 70% versus yes. 35%, yes. Because you can do it to spur growth in certain areas.
Okay.
Can I give a point?
Any further questions?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
You're actually, by approving the ordinance, you are approving the fees at 100% as to what the consultant said. What you're also doing is deciding to levy the fees at a different rate than what was approved or recommended in the study. So if you go 60 or 70 or 35 on one side, that's perfectly fine. With our consultant, we reviewed that with him. So you're well within your purview to do what you need to do.
Thank you. Further discussion questions? Councilman Lawler.
Yeah, I'm still confused on how reducing the amount to 60% benefits anybody that flooded. If that could be explained to me.
It wasn't, I didn't say anything about flooded. I said hardships.
Oh, even hardships then. I'd like that to be explained to me how, I mean, the hardship I'm assuming is based on
I can explain one hardship. Because of the flooding, the homes and the building costs have went from probably $110 a square foot to $130-something dollars a square foot to build a home nowadays. So not so much for the flooded victims, but even for the individuals that's building homes have been up close to $20 a square foot higher. You can check with any of your developers and probably got some out here that can probably answer that for you.
Do you have anything else?
From 2 years ago, I know it went from 110 to 115 a square foot to over 130 because of building material costs, supply and demand. So, yes, there are some hardships for people that's building homes. It's costing them quite a bit more. So,
what I'd like to say,
that is the reason for my...
Then I really would not like to hear anybody complaining about our transportation woes or people moving in or that we don't have enough money for transportation. If people can't spend $20, $30 when they're building a $200,000, $300,000 house, you know, then don't tell me that we don't have enough money for transportation. Don't tell me that our roads are too clogged when we can't stand up and say, hey, we're going to charge a little bit more money for new people, generally, majority, new people moving into the parish. Don't tell me that we don't have enough money for that, because that is extremely short-sighted.
Councilman Kluwat.
Yes. Given the explanation that none of the flood victims are going to be affected by that, I'll cordially pull my second to the motion and revert back to the settlement.
I don't know, Roberts is going to go crazy on this, but I did. So you don't have a second. Let's see if we can get another second on the reduce the levy from 70 to 60. No second. So now we're back to the original resolution, which is to implement to levy the fees at 70%. Just like to remind everybody that we 70% brings it more or less level with what the current fees are today. But this also brings in a CPI adjustment, as we just read. Right. So now we have the to adopt the ordinance as amended with the First Amendment and at the rates that we're in there. Discussion. Mr. Sadley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to clarify something that our planning director, Mr. Fournier, said, is that Duncan's was fine with the 75 and 35%. I'm sure, Jerome, you meant by that they're fine with us and our legal ability and right to alter their recommendation. Nonetheless, their recommendation is 100% of base, correct? Because if it ain't, then why did they recommend it? If not, they're saying they're recommending 70 or whatever.
No.
The meeting I had privately with them, you were there and everything, mm-hmm. They recommended we do 100%.
Yeah. They basically said that the fees levied at 100%
are fair.
Fair, and that's what they're recommending in their report.
Okay,
but they also said that you can levy something less
correct,
than that.
Correct, and that's what I'm saying.
Right.
Just so the record now is clear on that.
Yes.
Now, number two, I wholeheartedly agree and endorse what Mr. Lawler said. I'll use a little higher volume. Don't tell me either about the traffic problems in this parish when this council just voted over my objection to borrow and bond out $26 million for roads. And we're worrying about giving small concessions to not flood victims, not as that's clarified, but just some people to be voting, to be building. That's really not even fair to the people, frankly, in the subdivisions. If you're building a new home and you're bringing two more cars to a lot that was undeveloped and you are legitimately having an impact on our transportation infrastructure, which we all agree is woefully behind, again, why not pay the full recommended amount that Duncan's is saying would be fair to offset the burden that new development places on infrastructure? Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Any opposition? We have opposition, Madam Secretary.
Councilman Satterley.
No, only because I'd like to see 100%.
Councilman Kluwat.
Yes.
Councilman Joseph.
Yes.
Councilman Lawler.
Yes.
Councilwoman Casso.
Yes.
Councilman Lambert.
Yes.
Councilman Cagnolotti.
Yes.
Councilman Johnson.
Yes.
Chairman Dawson?
Yes. Okay. Ordinance is adopted. Council.
You good?
Item number 18. Councilman Cagnolotti. Any objections?
Wait.
Oh, sorry.
I just wanted a second. I want to wish a happy birthday to my granddaughter, Sophia.
Oh, what?
I'll second that.
Princess Sophia.
Princess. Thank you.